specialist, and I'm also a principal reviewer for the American Journal of Sports Medicine. And the role I'm playing today is a reviewer of science, just like I'm a reviewer of medicine submitted to the journal that I'm a principal reviewer.
Okay, my pen name is Truman Ardent Smith. I wrote a booklet that's on Amazon.com. And in this program guide here, you can see the booklet I wrote and also the one that Bart wrote. It tells you a little bit about us. I'm a former evangelical Christian, and I left Christianity. A big reason for that is probably to do with evolution.
Okay.
So, should I start my presentation now?
Well, let's see. I just want to take a little time. So you have 15 minutes to start your presentation, or to do your opening.
Okay. Ready?
Take a look.
Okay. First slide. Got it. Okay, I have two parts to my presentation. The first part is a general overview of science, and the second one is some DNA or some evidence for evolution. Next slide. Go the other way. There we go. I wanted to recommend this book here. This is a book about critical thinking. And so this is some philosophy coming in here. Basically, what this book, and you can buy this at half.com, this older edition, for $5, including postage. So I would definitely recommend this for your library. It's written by a couple of philosophy professors. They use this at Portland State University in the critical thinking course. It'll teach you how you can gain knowledge, and for example, why dreams and visions and prophets and things like that are not a good source for knowledge. They may be a good source for creating a hypothesis, but that hypothesis has to be tested. And also, there's logical reasoning, and sometimes that goes astray when you use logical fallacies. And so, this will teach you about some of the basic logical fallacies. And next page. So what is a hypothesis? Well, we find ourselves in a world where we have all these facts. For example, we have fossils, we have DNA code, and our goal is to try to piece this all together. How can we make sense of this? So basically, you can say a hypothesis is the inference to the best explanation. And so we want to. So now our goal is we have all these different hypotheses about how the world came to be. How did humans come to be? How did the universe come to be? How did the Earth come to be? How can we test these? Well, like this book I'm recommending, it has suggested five criteria. One is testability. Can your hypothesis be tested? For example, if you say, well, God did it by a miracle, you can't really test that if it's a one-time event. But if you said, well, things evolve, there's all kinds of tests you can think up, and there's a lot of scientific literature on this. So testability, if you can't test it, then you can't really find out if it's true or not. I mean, if you can get some validating evidence, that can give you some more confidence that it might be true. And if you get something that disconfirms it, then you can say, okay, well, at least now I know it's not right, now I can maybe revise my hypothesis and get closer to the truth. So that's why testability is really important. Fruitfulness is, can your hypothesis predict things? For example, in evolution, they'll say, well, if evolution is correct, we might expect to see this certain fossil in this certain area. Then people have gone digging for those exact fossils and they have found them. But if you say, for example, well, I think God just created things by a miracle, well, what can you predict? Well, I don't know if you can really predict anything from that. So that makes that hypothesis very difficult to be called science. Also scope, when you find a bone, you say, well, I have a perfect explanation for that one bone, but it doesn't really relate to a lot of other things. But if if it has a wide scope, for example, you might say, well, according to evolutionary theory, we found this bone in a certain layer of dirt, and we expect to find similar organisms across the entire world. And so it reaches, has a bigger scope that way. It explains more than just one little artifact. Simplicity is using what they call Occam's razor, where the hypothesis is trying to solve a mystery, and you don't want to add more mysteries in your explanation. So, for example, if you say, well, God did a miracle, and that's how everything came to be, well, that's not much of an answer, because now instead of answering the question, now you're bringing up more questions. Well, what is this God? Who is this God? And all this stuff. So if you have a naturalistic explanation, it's a lot more simpler and easier to test. And conservatism is, when you have a hypothesis, does this like totally overturn everything we already know, or is this like already in line with what we know in other fields, for example, physics and chemistry and all that? So does it greatly contradict our background knowledge, or is it conducive with it? Next slide. One of the warning about some creationist tactics that I've seen used, one is to say like, well, evolution's not true, let me point out one little thing, and then if you say, well, here's the answer for that, well, here's another thing, well, here's the answer for that, well, here's another thing, well, I've never heard that one before, well, yeah, you should go look into it, because that's evidence against evolution. So basically, it's taking these pot shots, and what I want to say is, it's the wrong way to go at it. What you need to do, if you want to be really honest about this and use a scientific method, is create a better hypothesis and say, my hypothesis is better than yours. So as long as you're just taking pot shots, you're not really having a good view at this. You're just trying to shoot something down with bad motives. And so, for example, I know Bart is partial to young earth creationism. It's called creation science, where they think maybe 4,000 years ago there was a worldwide flood. The whole universe and everything was created about, you know, who knows, around 7,000 years ago or so. Now, saying in science, it's pretty bad if a scientist is off by 2x, but this conflicts with modern science by 2x times 1 million. So the universe has not been around 7,000 years. You multiply that by 1,000 and you get 7 million. Multiply by another 1,000, you get 7 billion, and double it, 14. So this is a huge difference. And this is, I hope Bart's going to give up alternate hypothesis instead of just try to shoot holes, because if you see his alternate hypothesis, I think you would say, well, obviously evolution makes better sense than this. That conflicts with everything we know. Next slide. Also, there's kind of a battle of worldviews here, because a lot of creationists, you know, they have this old mentality where, you know, they're very special and the world revolves around them, kind of an idea. Whereas with evolution, you really learn how insignificant you are, and you have to deal with that. There's kind of maybe some emotional things involved with that. So for example, in the scientific view, and I'm saying scientific, not atheist, because there's a lot of Christians and scientists who also go for this 100%. It's all about evolution. It starts with cosmological evolution, which explains how everything came from energy. You got matter. At the time of the Big Bang, there was no matter whatsoever. Then stars were formed, and there's a thing called nucleosynthesis, where other chemicals are made. So from this cosmological evolution, we get biological evolution, where we get life coming from non-life. And then I add on there mimetic evolution, which is the ideas of thoughts, and this is going to high technology. So basically, cosmological evolution, the biological evolution, the mimetic evolution. I'm looking at the past and the present and the future here. In the past, we have cosmological, like I said, pure energy going to chemical elements, going to biological life, going into sentience, which is, you know, the humans have the most advanced brains, and now we are creating robots and computers. And when you look at technology, just think what the next 100 years will bring, or the next 1,000, or the next 1,000,000 years, and we could be on Earth for 100 million years, even though, you know, a Christian might be thinking, well, Jesus is going to come tomorrow, it's all going to be over. But if you have a scientific view, we might be here for another 100 million years. So think about what computers will be like 1,000,000 years from now. This is the importance of what I say is mimetic engineering. Next line. So now my next section is these are two points that we decided to talk about tonight so we can focus in instead of talk about everything. One claim from a creationist would be that biological evolution is statistically impossible, and the other claim is that there's no evidence for macroevolution at all, which is one species going to another species. Okay, so one thing I just wanted to warn about, I don't think Bart does this, but some people say like, well, I know evolution is not true because it's just so, life is so amazing and so complex, it's just too wonderful, it just cannot happen by itself. I want to give you the idea that you can't say that it's impossible or it can't happen, because that is mathematical language of statistics. It's math, it needs to be calculated. You can't go by feeling on this. And one thing Richard Dawkins talks about, which I think is a very powerful antidote, is saying that, you know, we evolved to middle world kind of thinking. We understand 3 minutes and 3 miles, but if you say something is 3 light years, we don't really grasp it. You know, 3 light years, 6 light years, it's all the same to us. I have no idea how far that is. I can't really comprehend it. But if you tell me three miles or 3 minutes, I know the difference between 3 minutes and 6 minutes, because that's my world I live in. In the same way, I work in a computer company, and we're down to the nanometers, which is a billionth of a meter. And we can't imagine that. And I know you're thinking, well, how do you see something that small? Well, we zoom it up. We have a zoom function, so we just zoom all the way in. Next. So biological, so somebody like Bart will say, well, on page 35, in fact, you show some calculations. This shows that it's statistically impossible. My point I'm trying to make here is you cannot calculate the probability if you don't know the process. For example, if I had a bunch of cards here and I said, what are the odds of pulling out an ace of hearts? Somebody might say, well, it's 1 in 52. That's perfectly fine as long as it's a standard deck. But if you ask me, is that a standard deck, and I don't answer, you can't say, well, I know it's 1 in 52. Let me show you all the calculations. It's obvious. What if I replaced all the aces or all the red cards or made them all aces, you know? It could be 0% or 100%. So all these assumptions mean nothing. So until you know how the process happens, you cannot calculate the statistical probability of it. And I've seen people do this mistake on both sides. One saying, statistically, it's impossible that life could arise from non-life. The other one says, no, statistically, it's possible. Either way, until you know the process or even get a hint of how it could happen, which we don't have, there's no way to calculate it. So I'm saying it's bogus to calculate any kind of probabilities. Now about evidence for evolution, I'm going to focus just on the DNA evidence because I think it's the most conclusive and it's also extremely rich and new. Since the year 2000, we've had the human genome sequenced, and since then also other animals. And this is a field called genomics where you can compare the DNA across animals and you can see the changes happen. Just like they descended. So really either there's descent happened or else there's some kind of creator who's trying to deceive you by making it look like it happened when it really didn't. Okay, so next line. For example, on YouTube, this guy is an evangelical Christian scientist and he has this long video about all the evidences for evolution because he's trying to teach his evangelical Christian brethren the evidence for it. And I'm going to go over one of those slides that he presents. Next line. So he basically talks about comparing the genome across human, chimp, dog, and fish, and you can see a lot of changes here. The top line is human, the next where it says HS, PT is chimp. This is only a partial listing of the DNA for insulin. Okay, and so what you see here is there's groupings of three DNA nucleotides. Every grouping of three maps to an amino acid, and this long amino acid sequence makes a protein. So what you find out is when you look at humans and chimps, for example, you'll see that the amino acids are kind of the same. They are pretty much the same, except for there's one change there. So you'd say, like, why would they be the same if there wasn't some kind of common descent there? Well, somebody might argue, just they have the same kind of function. Well, when you look at the other animals, like the fish and the dog, you can see the changes gradually happen more and more. So another thing I wanted to mention, for example, on here is, that's on the amino acid level where there's three nucleotides coding for this. Okay, now if you go up one, you'll notice the actual code behind these. For example, alanine over here, leucine, for example, here, we have CTC and CTG. Well, what is the code for leucine? There is no one code for leucine. For example, leucine could be CTC, CTA, CTG, CTT, TTA, TTG. Any of these combinations would pull the same exact amino acid. And in fact, here you can see the code's different, but it's the same exact amino acid. That means once you have this amino acid, this is irrelevant. This is what your body is reacting to and using. So what this shows is that there are a lot of different combinations that could have been made, but what happens is just a certain random one was chosen for that amino acid. And now look what happens. It turns out there's a one-bit difference between this one and this one. So I mean, it's easily there's some kind of relationship there. It's kind of like if you looked at two papers and you're a teacher, and you say, hey, look, this guy copied from this guy. There's so many different ways he could have wrote this, and they wrote it the same, and there's one change. So this is the obvious change that you have. Now, the argument he calls this is redundancy, because there's so many redundant codes for an amino acid, but it just so happens to use the same code. So if there's an intelligent designer behind this, you'd think, well, if this really wasn't descent, then he's trying to fool us to make it look that way, like he's trying to deceive you. And of course, people who believe in God don't think their God's a deceiver. Next line. Then there's signs of unintelligent design, such as the recurrent laryngeal nerve, which goes, it's supposed to go to your brain, to your voice box, and it turns out it goes and loops around the heart. Well, there's no reason for that, but when you look at evolution, we know why it happened, because of the fish. It goes direct from the fish, but as a sea animal went to a land animal, the neck elongated, and part of that got trapped into the heart. And so the most absurd example is in an elephant, where it has like a 20-foot trip all the way down to the heart and back again, when it only needs just to go to the head and the neck.
Giraffe.
The giraffe, sorry. I don't know what I said. Next line. So this basically shows how this is real. Here it just shortened the fish, and it gets, as became a land animal, got a little bit longer than the giraffe. It goes all the way down here and back here, and it only needs to go right here. Next line. Another sign of unintelligent design is we have this non-coding DNA. We don't need it. It looks like junk. Well, how do we know it's junk? Well, one scientist said, let's delete a whole bunch of it. They deleted over 2 million nucleotides. And then they compared it, and they found out with these modified mice, there's no difference between the wild ones. Next. And then maybe if there is an ID designer too, maybe he's evil. Like, this is what Mark Twain said. It's like, flies are so good at spreading infection. They go to a kid with goopy eyes and goes to a dung and spreads the disease that way, and all these plagues and everything spread by the fly. You think if we found out a human designed this fly and let it go, we'd probably say this guy's created a weapon of mass destruction. Let's put this guy in jail. It's kind of like a Hitler kind of guy. Next line. So basically that's it. Probability, I don't think you can calculate it because we don't know the process. And the second one is the evidence for evolution. I only touched a little teeny part, but I think it's very convincing and powerful on the DNA. That's it.
We are the Freethinkers of Portland State. We're the secular group on campus. We are a group where atheists and agnostic students can associate and make friends, and we are the largest secular voice on campus. We have several Facebook pages, just look us up. We host meetings twice a week, and we put on all kinds of events such as this one. We highly recommend that if you're a student to get involved. Maybe even if you're not a secularly minded person. We have coffee and cookies in the back, so if you guys want some. It's really hot in this room, so we should have actually gotten a nice one. My apologies.
By the way, Stephen, after 1 hour, before we do the Q&A, let's take a break so I can just sit down. It only takes about 20 seconds.
Setting up. This talk is based on a book I just had published earlier this year. It's pretty unique. It's a purely analytical discussion about evolution. And what's unique about it, two things. Number one, it's a purely scientific discussion, and it's peer-reviewed by two evolutionary biologists who disagree with everything I say, one from Cal Berkeley and the other from Oregon State. So you see my views and you see their opinions of my view. So, I'm going to talk about why I don't believe in evolution. Just to define it, evolution by the National Science Foundation is modification with descent from a common ancestor. The mechanism of change is mutation, migration, genetic drift. Of these, mutation is the mechanism for changing genes. Migration, drift, natural selection concern just increasing the frequency of these mutants within the population. I believe in microevolution, changes within kind. I do not believe that one species could give rise to a physiologically different species. There are empirical limits to evolution, which are the microevolution limits, based on observation experience. The limits I've found is there's no ability to evolve reproductive isolation, nor an increase in physiologic complexity. No ability to increase complexity of pre-existing physiologic systems added by horizontal gene transfer. In my review of over 400 studies, there are no exceptions to these limits. Never observed, evolution says that one species can give rise to two different species which are completely reproductively isolated each other from each other, even in vitro. This process has never been documented. Also never documented is increased in physiologic complexity. The bacteria flagellum, which is a little tail that makes it swim, is made of relatively few proteins. The eukaryotic one, or animal flagellum, has many more proteins. It has never been observed that one species can give rise to another species that has more body parts. Now, evolution has no science, has no evidence, has no science. These standard textbooks are my references for science and logic. There's two types of theories and beliefs, those that are scientific, which are testable and have empirical evidence, such as the law of gravity, and those that are faith-based or non-scientific. Now, they can be true. Now, George Washington crossed the Delaware in 1776, but you can't do an experiment to demonstrate it. I believe in intelligent design, but I acknowledge you can't do a test for it, and there's no empirical evidence for it. I would put evolution in the same category as astrology, as a pseudoscience, because it's not testable, and there's no empiric evidence for it. I'll explain. Now, Truman and I actually agree on the, it seems like we agree on the criteria for science. And you can see my references. Most philosophers and scientists agree. There has to be a test of the theory, needs to predict the phenomena or observations. It has to be falsifiable and empirical evidence. Now, the problem is arguments claiming the testability and falsifiability require mischaracterizing what the theory of evolution is. Nick Matsky, evolutionary biologist from Cal Berkeley, says, science is about proposing hypotheses and testing them. The fossil record is one such test. Evolution predicted that transitional forms would be found. The problem is, evolution is not simply the static existence of transitional forms. National Science Foundation, evolution is descent with modification from a common ancestor. It's a dynamic theory, not a static theory. A more accurate test would be if you could see offspring from a common ancestor could modify into transitional forms in modern species. A biologist named Haldane said evolution would be falsifiable if you could find modern fossil rabbits from the pre-Cambrian era. This is mischaracterized. Evolution is not simply the static existence of different fossils at different times. It's a dynamic process that says that you can get descent from modification from a common ancestor. A more accurate way of falsifying it would be if you can show descendants from this pre-Cambrian ancestor could not modify into the modern rabbit. But this isn't falsifiable because it allegedly occurred over 507 million years. So why is evolution evidence not evidence? Well, because it's illogically interpreted. Now, logic is involved in making conclusions about your observations. There is deductive reasoning. Now, we have this conditional argument. So if the condition is it's raining, then it would be wet, which is the consequent. Or consequence. So the condition raining would lead to it is wet. So if you affirm the condition or you see that the condition exists, such as it is raining, you can with confidence say that it is wet. So if it is raining, it is wet. Now, but you turn things around and you have a logical fallacy called the fallacy of affirming the consequent. So if you affirm the consequent that is wet, the condition is raining, is not necessarily true. In my research, this is by far the most common logical error in the field of evolution, and evolutionists just don't seem to grasp this concept. So, if evolution is true, then you would see the fossil record and DNA similarity. We affirm the consequent. There is, in fact, a fossil record and DNA similarity. Therefore, the evolution is true. We wrongly conclude the conditioned evolution by affirming the consequent, which is the fossil record and so on. Now, if the sun revolved around the Earth, it would rise in the east and set in the west. We do see the sun rise in the east and set in the west. We're affirming the consequent. Therefore, the sun revolved around the Earth. We wrongly conclude the conditioned by affirming the consequent. So, evolutionists say that the fossil record, DNA similarity, pseudogenes, biological diversity all fit the evolution model. But observations that fit the model do not necessarily support the theory and could be wrong, as I showed you with the sun around the Earth model. Any nonsense theory could be made up to fit a model. Science requires that a test of the model produce the observations. DNA similarity fossils are observations with their evolution only assumed. Another argument they use is plausibility reasoning. Evolution is the simplest, most plausible explanation for a fossil record and DNA similarity. Not true. Plausibility depends on prior observations. For some, so suppose you have you come upon a destroyed trailer park in Oklahoma. There's no one around to tell you what happened. What do you conclude? That a microwave oven exploded or there was a tornado that hit? Well, you know it's a tornado is the plausible answer from prior experience in other situations. No one's around to tell you what happened in this situation, but from prior situations you know that a tornado is the plausible answer. Well, evolution has never been seen to cause changes to the degree claimed by evolutionists, such as causing transitions in fossils and making the DNA similar among various species. So, fair question. If evolution studies don't support evolution, then what do they support? I found two categories. They're either show microevolution, or the study is simply a description of comparative biology. The study simply compares DNA fossils and biochemical pathways and chromosomes among various species and simply assume that the evolution occurred. For microevolution, there is invoked the fallacy of the slippery slope. The scientist sees a small change in a small time and then by extrapolation says that there can be a large change over millions of years. But you can't say this because there's no empiric evidence for it. Remember, evolution says claims to be a science. Science is the discipline of determining the limits of what's possible in nature. The comparative biology studies, evolution, remember, is the theory of a dynamic process that the species of the evolutionary tree are ancestrally connected. But the evidence given in many studies are simply the tips of these branches, such as the DNA diversity. So in the studies, they commit the fallacy of affirming the consequent. They show these tips, such as the DNA diversity, and simply assume that they're connected by branches. Would it be possible? No, because evolution requires a phenomenon called complementary coevolution, which is where two genes must evolve simultaneously for intermolecular fit. Intermolecular fit is done in nearly all biochemical processes. So intermolecular fit is accomplished by having two molecules match each other, fit each other by virtue of their three-dimensional shape and electrical charges. These shapes and charges are determined by the DNA code, which is a series of A, G, C's, and T's, arranged in an order similar to a computer code. Complementary coevolution required by evolution is impossible because a random mutation in one gene restricts how another or partner gene can create or maintain intermolecular fit of gene products. Since genes can be hundreds of nucleotides, obtain the necessary permutations for protein intermolecular fit would be impossible. So this shows an animal cell. Inside the nucleus is the chromosome, and the chromosome consists of a string of these billions of A, G, C's, and T's, which make up the genes. So this is an illustration of the gene-partner gene concept. Oops. We have two genes. Anyway, the point is there are two genes. Oh, there we go. Okay. It is working. Okay, so you have two genes. They can be from different chromosomes. They produce a product. Each produces a protein product that fits and matches to make a function. Examples are on the left. There are literally thousands of these. You open up almost any page of a biochemistry book, and you'll see this type of reaction. Now, if one of them mutates, you have problems. So the little red C on the bottom gene causes a change in its shape and charges, so there's no longer a fit between the molecules. So where this is important is in species-specific mating. That's one example out of thousands. A Soviet biologist impregnated female chimp with human sperm, and there was no fertilization. At Cornell University in New York City, in vitro fertilization attempt was done between human sperm and about seven other mammals. No fertilization despite direct sperm and egg contact. So, can evolution explain species-specific mating? Well, for fertilization to occur, there's one process occurs is called the acrosome reaction, where the sperm and egg meet, their membranes fuse, the sperm deposits its DNA material into the egg. But if they're different species, the receptors on the sperm and egg don't match each other, and so there can't be any mating between the two species. Sperm and egg receptors from different species generally will not fit. Evolution requires complementary coevolution of sperm and egg receptors to explain species-specific sperm and egg fusion. So, chimp and man presumably came from a common ancestor. Evolution requires that any mutation done in the sperm would have to be matched by a complementary mutation in the egg, such that the human sperm and egg can match, yet do not match with the chimp. And it's my belief that this is statistically impossible because of all the little nucleotides needed to create these matching complementary proteins. So the statistical analysis that Truman was referring to is how easy is it to get complementary mutations in two genes such that the, they do know the nucleotides sequence of the sperm and egg receptors of chimp and human. There's at least a 300 nucleotide difference between the two. So the chance a common ancestor could get just six of these required mutations. Well, you must account for the fact that there's four nucleotides. The gene size is 1,294 bases long. So the chance of getting a mutation in the right part of the gene is 1 over 1294 for the first one. For the second one, it's 1 over 1293. So you do the math times six mutations, and it's statistically impossible to get the required six mutations in an attempt to close the gap between the 300 nucleotide difference between the two species. There's logistic problems in sperm and egg evolution. Evolution requires the belief that every egg mutation, you overcome astronomical odds to mutate a fitting sperm at the same time and same place. It does no good if the mutant sperm and egg are matching each other and mutating 300 years or 3,000 miles apart. And they also must not be outcompeted by the more numerous original sperm. So complementary coevolution, the significance of it, I think it explains the empiric limits of microevolution because involving reproductively isolated species and species with greater complexity would require complementary coevolution for intermolecular fit. So the theory of evolution does not meet the criteria for science. Arguments that say it does mischaracterize the theory of evolution. The reported evidence merely shows microevolution or describes biologic diversity with the evolution merely assumed. The empiric limits of microevolution, it has never been documented that reproductive isolation could occur by evolution, nor an increase in physiologic complexity. And since there are thousands of biochemical systems that require intermolecular fit, their DNA sequence complementary coevolution would be impossible. And finally, the scientific validity of evolution does not depend upon the strengths and weaknesses of competing theories. If evolution is considered a science, it must meet the criteria: testability, falsifiability, and empiricism. That's all.
Now we have the 10-minute cross-examinations, starting with Truman.
Okay, and if it's okay with you guys, the way I usually like to do this in a debate is that I'll be in the driver's seat when it's my turn, and so basically when I ask a question, it's supposed to be interactive, and I can interrupt and things like that to try to get an answer out of the person without a lecture response or a sermon response. And then when the tables are turned, I behave in the same way. I don't give a lecture response. We try to have a dialogue to see if we can interact with each other. Is that okay?
Sure.
Okay, so it's not being rude to interrupt here, okay? Did you start the timer?
No.
Okay, can you give me like a, when it's 1 minute left? Okay, so I heard you use a lot of phrases. This certain thing has never been observed or documented, or can evolution explain this? And now one thing I want to bring up is there's a logical fallacy called appeal to ignorance. And this is when people try to say, can you explain this? Well, if not, that's evidence from my side for some reason. Not knowing something is not evidence for either side. You have to know that. You can't say, hey, you can't explain this, therefore it's my point. It's nobody's point. So it's totally irrelevant when he says, oh, evolution can't explain this or can't explain that. Of course, there's a lot of things evolution can't explain. And the theory is constantly getting revised. So I guess my question to you is, do you understand that there is a logical fallacy called appeal to ignorance?
Yeah, I'm aware of it, but I'm not invoking it. The issue is that if there's, so you're saying that because I say there's no evidence for it, evolution can't be true.
No, you're trying to say like these certain things can't happen because we've never, it's never been observed, or there's no way that we know that this could happen, like the flagellum, how could that thing come to be? We don't know, therefore it's evidence against evolution.
I'm not saying that it's, what I'm saying is that evolution, since it's called a science by those who teach it, requires to have evidence. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is there is no evidence for it. And so my claim is that it's not a science because there's no, now you're saying, I think you're saying is that since there's no evidence, I can't say that it could happen, or
well,
could not happen.
Well, specifically, what did you say about the flagellum?
Well, I said it's never been documented that a flagellum from one species can give rise to a flagellum with more parts of another species.
Is that evidence against evolution? Or does that appeal to ignorance?
That shows that there's a limit, an empirical limit on what evolution can accomplish.
No, I think it shows that we don't know, there's certain things we don't know. It's not a limit. If we don't know, we may discover it. It could be discovered tomorrow.
If it's discovered tomorrow, then it could be classified as a science. But until that evidence, since that evidence doesn't exist, okay, then you can't call it a science. So what I'm saying
anyway, we both agree in principle that if we don't know something, that's not evidence for either side, right?
That's correct.
Let's just leave it there. The other thing is, you don't, I think it's kind of a cheap shot to say evolution is a poor hypothesis without submitting a better one. I gave my presentation that we need, in science, we need to look at all available hypotheses and see which one stands, which one looks best in light of all the data. And you are not proposing an alternate hypothesis. You're saying, look how bad this hypothesis is. Why aren't you proposing a better alternative?
Because the alternative I believe in is intelligent design. But the problem is, I'm not an expert in it. So I'm not very good at defending it. I believe in computer science, but I'm not an expert in it, so I can't defend it. And my thesis is not what a better alternative is. My thesis is that evolution cannot be considered a real science because it doesn't meet the criteria.
Okay, so in the back of your mind, you think idea is a better alternative, but you're saying you don't understand it very well. Maybe once you understand it better, you'll say like, well, maybe that's poorer than evolution.
No, because evolution, again, has different criteria. You can believe in things that are faith-based, like you can believe in historical events that are purely faith-based. But evolution has a different standard because it's called a science. There has to be empiricism, falsified testability.
Okay.
It's hard for me to believe something that doesn't meet any of the criteria and call it. It's sort of a conflict of reason.
Okay, so I try to make a very important point that in science, it's very important to look at all the alternative hypotheses and see which one makes the most sense. And you're saying you're not doing that. You're only looking at one to shoot holes in it, and you're not looking at alternative hypotheses to see if they're any better.
I do look at alternative hypotheses, but I'm not very good at defending the alternative. The topic today is evolution and whether it qualifies as a science and whether there's evidence for it.
Okay.
So,
well, I think it would be helpful to tell people if you think idea is better, why it's better.
Again, it's outside of my field of expertise, and I'm not very good at that. It would be a waste of everybody's time. That we're here to talk about evolution and and why we think it's, why you're here to talk about why you think it's a good theory, scientific theory,
right, right.
And I'm here to give the counter.
Yeah, I want to make clear the reason why I think it's a good theory is because it's better than all the alternatives. And especially if you're going to write a book, I think you should know what all the alternatives are and say, I've studied all the alternatives and this is the best one.
That's one way of approaching it, but that's not my, my approach is, okay. Is I'm taking evolution at its, for what it's called. I'm challenging them on those who teach evolution that it's a science when it doesn't qualify.
Okay.
So I'm taking a very narrow focus on it so I don't get trapped into
okay.
things I'm not an expert in.
Do I have very much time or yeah. how much more time? Full time. Okay, good. So I gave evidence for the left recurrent laryngeal nerve. Why isn't that obvious evidence for evolution? I mean, it's explained perfectly if you're common sense, but it seemed like it makes no sense with IUD. Why would somebody, like I was telling my son earlier, it's like if you had a stereo in your car going to your speaker, but instead of going right to your speaker, you wrapped around your engine and then came back to your speaker. Why would you design that? But with evolution, it makes perfect sense.
Again, I don't know. See, evolution, the reason the recurrent laryngeal nerve is the way it is because of the embryology and development, and not because of some ancestor. There's been no, I don't understand the relationship between the route of the recurrent laryngeal nerve and descent with modification. I don't understand
well,
the relationship.
Well, in the fish, it's a direct connection. And then when you start to look at land animals, you can see where as the neck developed, it got stuck around, one of these nerves got stuck around the heart area. And so now that's the way it is, it's stuck there. So as the neck gets bigger and bigger in animals, like the giraffe, for example, it has no choice but to continue to just get bigger. And so...
So what you're saying is that if evolution were true, you'd see a gradually longer recurrent laryngeal nerve.
Well, I'm saying with evolution, there's a good explanation for why it happened, and we can see it progress through different animals. But with intelligent design,
is there evidence for this explanation?
The evidence is looking at the progression through different animals, like the fish and then the land animals. And
see, that's a problem I have with the interpretation. All you show are these static differences among various species, but evolution is a theory that one gave rise to the other through processes of random mutation, natural selection. That's what I call my descriptions of comparative biology. That is involved in the fallacy of affirming the consequent. Evolution would give a gradually lengthened recurrent laryngeal nerve, mm-hmm. therefore evolution. We see the recurrent laryngeal nerve affirming the consequent, therefore evolution. Mm-hmm. So you're committing the fallacy of affirming the consequent.
Okay.
And you're not really showing that evolution occurred.
Okay, let's talk about
so it's a nice hypothesis, but there's no evidence to support it.
Okay, how much time do I have? About 2 minutes? Okay, so let's talk about your affirming the consequence. So you're saying if evolution is true, you see transitionary creatures. We see some transitionary creatures, but not necessarily evolution is true. Is that what you're
correct?
Saying? Okay, why are we seeing transitional creatures if they're intelligently designed?
Again, I'm not an expert on intelligent design.
Because basically, evolution is all about descent with modification. Now, if things were created individually, this is what you're saying, your alternative. If you're against evolution, what you're saying is things were created independently without descent. So if they're independently, there's no reason to have transitionary creatures.
Truman, you keep trying to get me to try to defend intelligent design, but I acknowledge I'm not an expert in it and I can't give an explanation. But intelligent design is a faith-based theory that requires no evidence, analogous to the history of ancient Rome. There's no test you can do to see what year Julius Caesar was emperor of Rome. It's purely based on faith that written documents are true. And I can't explain it. I'm not very good at it, just
okay.
like I can't explain computer engineering.
Well, my point is, in the big picture, evolution is about descent with modification. And it sounds to me like you're saying descent with modification is not science and it's not real how it happened. So I'm saying if there was not descent with modification, why would we see transitional creatures?
There wasn't.
Yeah.
Why wouldn't we see it?
Yeah, I mean, if things were individually created, you wouldn't expect to see transitionary creatures. There's no point for it, unless you want to mislead somebody to think there was.
That's a philosophical question. Why is there diversity among nature? Why are there a million sexually reproduced? I don't know.
Well, I would just say it's logic, though.
Well,
it's logic for you.
Well, deductive logic doesn't lead one to describe the diversity in nature to conclude evolution. Evolution, because there's no demonstration of descent with modification. All you're showing is these endpoint tips of the evolutionary tree. You're not demonstrating that it's possible to make a connection among them.
Okay.
Right.
We'll jump off until the end of these conclusions. Dr. Rask will give his cross-examination of Mr. Smith.
Well, we discussed most of our... one thing you mentioned is that you talked about how you can't do any calculations because we don't know the process. Would you agree that if you don't know the process of evolution, then it's a very vague theory, and then it can't be classified as a science?
Okay, there's actually two parts to evolution. There's a part that's a fact, and that's that we descended from other animals. That's the stuff we can deduce from looking at the fossil record, the DNA and all that stuff. The second part is the mechanisms. How did it happen? And that's the theory part that's continually getting revised with new data. You know, like Darwin came up with this and he had no idea of DNA whatsoever. You know, so...
How do we know that it's a fact? What is the evidence that determines it's a fact?
Like I'd like to put up here on the DNA evidence, we can see the bits. You can, in genomics, you can look and... It's just like I said, if you're a teacher and you have a written assignment and these things come back, you can tell if somebody was copying or not. And so by looking at the DNA code in genomics, that's what it's obvious.
So what you're saying is since there's similarity in DNA, then there must have been a common ancestor.
Similarity, but not just similarity by itself. There's a thing called synteny where there are certain genes. For example, you might have a gene called ABC. In another genome, it's an ABC again. And there's no reason for it to be in a certain order, but it's ABC here, ABC here. Sometimes it's flipped over, ABC, CDA. And sometimes there's duplicates in there. So it's trying to say what's the inference of the best explanation for this.
How do you reconcile the fact that similar DNA among different species connotes a relationship when empirical evidence shows that only species that can mate with each other can have a common ancestor?
Well, I'm not really sure, but again, you're trying to, let's say I don't know the answer to that, or let's say science doesn't even know the answer to it. Again, you can't use the appeal to ignorance as evidence for your side. It could be just there's an unknown there. It's not evidence. If science doesn't have the answer yet, like I said, Darwin knew nothing of DNA, and you know.
All right. If the chimp and human sperm nucleotide difference of their receptors, if their difference is 300, and they're presumably from the common ancestor, would you agree that there has to be at least a one mutated 150 and one mutated 150 nucleotides, or one was the same and there was a 300 change?
Well, see, this is, I think, a big flaw in your calculations is you're talking about nucleotides, which the real thing is here is what they call a codon, which is a set of three nucleotides. Because nucleotides don't mean that much because of what I brought up here about redundancy. There's more than one way to code it. So even focusing on a nucleotide level, I think, is a mistake. I mean, I think that's a fatal flaw in your calculations.
Well, you're partially right. What they do is the three nucleotides code for amino acid. And when you take into account the redundancy, if there was a 300 nucleotide difference, to get considering the redundancy of the genetic code, at minimum there would have to be a 100 nucleotide difference.
Okay, but see again, my opinion is you can't talk of, you're talking about unknown processes. You can't calculate the odds of an unknown process. That's my point, that's my belief.
So you're saying that the evolution of sperm and egg receptors is an unknown process?
I don't know. For me personally, I don't know if the state of science is unknown or not. But if I agree with you, it's unknown.
How is the DNA?
If your calculations are right on, I mean, this is something where you could write this up and have this peer reviewed and make an accomplishment. But like I said, I think it's a fatal flaw when you don't even take into account codons.
Well, the codons would just decrease that 300 nucleotide difference down to probably 100.
Yeah, but it shows your calculations, even on this superficial level of me not being an expert, that's even me seeing something like that, what else is in there that's wrong?
All right. So you agree that that the mechanism for changing the DNA nucleotides is by randomization after selection and drift and so on?
Yeah, and there's also what they call horizontal gene transfer is another thing that, you know, they discovered and Darwin knew nothing about.
That's all I have.
Okay. We'll have concluding statements, 5 minutes each, starting with Truman Smith.
Okay, so this is a time where I make my comments on Bart's presentation. Bart makes a comment on mine, right? Okay. I think, number one, it's very bad science to just shoot at a hypothesis, try to tear it down without saying there's a better alternative. That's not going all the way. And if you want to do science, you need to say these are the different hypotheses and this is the best one. This is what this book here I'm promoting here, written by these two philosophy professors. For example, out-of-body experience. That's an interesting idea. How can we study this? Well, there's like 4 or 5 different hypotheses, and they go through each one to say which one might be the most reasonable. That's what you have to do. You just don't pick one and say, let's see if we can tear it to shreds or not, and then assuming that your favorite one is safely tucked away beyond reproach. You want to put them all up forward. I mean, put your own cherished one up there and see how well it compares against it. So I think that's a major shortcoming here from Bart of not looking at the big picture. And then as far as, like I said before, the calculations, I don't think you can calculate the statistics of anything unknown. You know, and evolutionists do it also. They say, oh, the odds aren't that high. And so either way, I don't think you can do that. I think the laryngeal nerve is excellent evidence for evolution. How else can you explain it? And, you know, Bart says he doesn't want to go there. He doesn't want to think about alternative explanations. He just wants to shoot down one. So, let's see what else, if there's anything else. I think that's about it.
Dr. Rask.
All right. My point of this talk is focusing only on the theory of evolution. It's claimed by those who teach it to be a science. And to be a science doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what alternative hypotheses are. There are objective criteria that almost all scientists agree on. That is, its testability, falsifiability, and existence of empirical evidence. Listed among those is not whether it's better than another theory. Whether it's better than another theory would qualify as what is a better faith if you're comparing two different faiths. But evolution, since it's called a science, it has more objective criteria it needs to live by. And that is the purpose of my talk, is to say that it doesn't live up to the objective criteria of science. So its comparisons to other hypotheses is not relevant. And I ask you to... Now, people out there, you don't have to believe anything I say. The one thing I've learned in my discussion with the two collaborators with my book is they just don't grasp the fallacy of the fermanent consequent. And Truman, he references that repeatedly. He talks about if evolution and recurrent laryngeal nerve, if evolution and common and degenerative codons, affirm the consequent. We see the recurrent laryngeal nerve, therefore evolution. It's pretty standard, that's logic, basic logic 101, that's an illogical conclusion. Now, you may say, no, the rejoinder that you have is this the best conclusion. Well, the problem is, in order to be considered a plausible conclusion, there has to be prior evidence to make it plausible. And that's my beef. There is no prior observable empirical evidence to make evolution a plausible conclusion to the fossil record and so on. It's never been shown to... Remember my analogy about the tornado destroying the Oklahoma town. Even if you didn't see it, we know from prior experience that tornadoes can do that sort of thing. So for something to be considered plausible, there has to be prior direct observation from analogous situations of which there exists none. That's all I have to say.
Okay, we will take a small 5-10 minute break, and then we will have a question and answer session that will be open to everybody.
How long is the break?
Let's make it 5 minutes. You might have to speak up because we do not have mics that we can pass around. So the first question goes to.
Okay. Dr. Rask, a couple points.
Stand up, turn around, or you wouldn't leave. I mean, you can stand up and turn around so everybody can hear you.
Just repeat your question.
Comment about primates and humans not being able to mate. Well, a common misconception is humans came from primates, and that's not true. Evolution says primates and humans are apes, and humans came from a common ancestor. Which, so that totally makes that irrelevant. Second is...
I missed that. What comment did I say was irrelevant?
That chimps and humans couldn't reproduce.
That's right.
But we don't come from one or the other. We come from a common ancestor.
No, okay, well, go ahead.
And you're thinking in concepts of 4,000 or 5,000 years. You're talking about humans have been around anywhere from 100 to 200,000 years, according to most biologists.
Well, let's take one comment at a time.
Okay.
So I acknowledge that the chimp-human thing is... My point in that discussion was that since there's a supposed common ancestor that gave rise to both man and chimp, and I pointed out that man and chimp can't reproduce with each other. My point was to show that phenomenon of one species giving rise to two different species that are reproductively isolated has never been observed. And if evolution were true, there would have to be evidence to support that. Go ahead.
Again, you're basing your concept on 4,000 or 5,000 years, right? You're a young earth creationist?
No, I'm basing my concept on empirical evidence, which is the criteria for science. You're making this assertion, faith-based assertion, that over millions of years there could have been a common ancestor. But remember, the criteria for science has to be testable, falsifiable, and empiricism. There's no empirical evidence to show that two species that don't mate had not a common ancestor that used to be able to mate. No one's ever established that that's possible. Go ahead.
Well, just one comment that I'll throw in there too. I think there's a good point here from the audience, and that is, you know, sometimes people think we evolved from the apes or from these other apes, but you know, really we're cousins. And the same way, yeah, a human and a chimp can't mate and make offspring, but neither can a human and a fish. And Dawkins said, if you go back 198, I think it's a million generations, what does our ancestor look like? It's a fish. So yeah, fish can't mate with humans either, but it doesn't really, I don't see how that really invalidates evolution.
Well, okay.
Next question. This is John in the back.
Okay. I'm a theistic determinist, so I'm really at odds with both speakers. I believe the Bible is very clear that God works through natural processes. How can you not abide that? Psalm 104. God,
I know the Bible is full of contradictions.
Yeah. The Bible, God works through natural processes, including what I call chronological.
What's your question? Hey, what's your question?
Okay, sir, what is your question?
My question is, how can you say there's no evidence for interspecies breeding? We're doing that experiments right now. We have all kinds of hybrids between species in the butterfly group we work with. I think you were very misleading in many of your statements. They simply aren't accurate.
I acknowledge that there are some species that can mate with each other, but there are a lot of species that cannot. And if evolution were true, it would have to explain the fact that many species cannot mate with each other. Now, if man and chimp have a common ancestor, and man and chimp we know cannot mate by virtue of these artificial insemination experiments, evolution has to explain that existence. And if evolution is considered to be a science, there has to be empirical evidence to support it. There is no empirical evidence that creatures that cannot mate used to be able to mate by virtue of a common ancestor. That's a total faith-based supposition.
That's exactly where our experiments are disproving. In fact, there is evidence.
There's evidence for what? I'm sorry.
That species that do not naturally intermate can be made to mate and produce offspring in the laboratory. That is empirical.
So what you're saying is there are some species that used to be reproductively isolated.
In nature, they're reproductively isolated. In the laboratory, we can induce cross-mating, producing offspring.
Okay, that's the opposite of what evolution shows. Evolution says that species that
What's
were...
the point of it? You twist everything I say. I quit. You're
describing the opposite, so we'll move on. Okay.
Next question goes to...
Yeah, I just have a question for Mr. Truman. I'm just a little bit curious of, since you believe in evolution, my question to you would be, what's your best evidence for life coming from non-living material? Like, how did that happen since...
Yeah, nobody knows that yet. Yeah. No, this is what I said. Remember, don't do the appeal to ignorance. That's a logical fallacy. You can't say, because we don't know that, that's evidence against evolution. It's not.
Well, there has to be some kind of evidence, because how did life start? There must be some kind of explanation. If there's no explanation, then how can you be talking about DNA?
That was last week.
Well, I'm just
saying. Do you think it is a valid scientific theory that, do you think abiogenesis is a valid scientific theory, or do you think it's a faith-based theory?
It's a scientific theory, and the reason why is because it could be testable, and that's what they're doing. They're doing all kinds of tests. Like the person in the audience said, they had a talk here last week where a scientist gave an update on the origins of life and how this stuff came about, and he said these are the steps that are needed, these are the progress that we have in each step, these are the mysteries we have, these are the things we found in the lab, you know?
Yeah, I've read those studies, and all those studies are simply assertions, but there's no evidence to back it up. For example, there's this gentleman...
What do you think, like nucleosynthesis, the elements being created by fusion and stars, do you think that's made up, or...?
Well, that's beyond the scope of evolution. I'm talking about...
Well, that's all part of it.
I'm not talking about
cosmic evolution.
We're talking about Earth-like evolution, not cosmic.
Okay.
We have to stay focused here. That's a fruitful discussion. Okay. So, I read those... There's a man named... a gentleman named Cavalier-Smith, who developed all sorts of scenarios of how life could have evolved. He talks about... ob cells, which are lipids that come together analogous to soap bubbles, and from those soap bubbles you get proteins. And when you read those studies, all it is just a simple hypothetical concoction, and there's no empirical evidence to back up that these things are possible. Okay. So I understand that there's these theories out there in people, but what it is just a series of assertions with no empirical evidence to back them up.
Well, it's a hypothesis, and they're looking for evidence. And so this is what science does. It tries to find out the unknown. There's a mystery there. Let's have a hypothesis. Let's figure out how to test it. So that's trying to unravel the mystery is what science is all about.
Are there any women in the audience who would like to ask a question? Take you in the back.
I was a Christian at one point, and then I went back to my atheist roots, since we're all born atheists, right? And so I thought biology is so fascinating, I have to study it, and evolution is so fascinating, so I have to study it. So many of these things you say, Doctor, just don't make sense, because it's not really bringing up what evolution is all about. So, for example, sorry, I was multitasking here.
That is one interpretation, just a question.
For one thing, species don't interbreed usually. They don't produce viable offspring because they're sterile. So that's not how evolution works, like the man over here said, that we branched off from a common ape-like ancestor about 6 million years ago. So that's how that works. We have Fred and Neanderthals.
Do you have a question for
Ms. Rask? So anyway, scientists haven't debated evolution for about a half a century. And so I was wondering, how can you believe in something that violates the laws of science like physics and chemistry?
Did everybody hear that?
No.
Sorry, what do you...
Well, you believe in intelligent design.
Correct.
Yet there's no peer-reviewed studies for intelligent design. There's thousands of studies that support evolution from a variety of scientific disciplines. So I'm wondering how can you just disregard thousands of scientific studies that are peer-reviewed and follow the scientific method, which means they can be duplicated. And evolution typically... Macroevolution, what you creationists like to refer to, occurs over millions of years. So how can there be empirical evidence? But you can see, right, And empirical evidence isn't always the method that scientists use, because do we see gravity?
There's empirical evidence that indicates.
Yeah, and there's empirical evidence that you can see transitional fossil species. That for every major transition.
Okay, well, that's enough. I'll address your points. So one point was empirical evidence of transitional fallacies, correct?
Yeah.
All right, fallacy confirming the consequent. Transitional fossils don't indicate that one was derived from the other by random mutation and natural selection. Fallacy confirming the consequent. Your other assertion was, how can I believe in intelligent design?
Oh, wait a minute, you didn't answer that. Why do you see fossil species all over? And you can see them going from land, from water to terrestrial, aquatic.
That's right.
Terrestrial environments.
I understand. There's a variability in fossils that can respond to different environmental factors, right? So we're seeing variability, but there's no evidence that this variability was derived by the dynamic process of evolution. No one's ever seen it happen. It can't be considered a plausible explanation because there's no analogous empirical evidence to say that it's plausible. Your other point about intelligent design, intelligent design...
I'm sorry, that's just not true.
I'm sorry.
Cytochrome C is a protein.
In the interest of time, I think we're having...
Next question.
All right.
Next question, please.
Troy. Just speak out a bit.
Oh, sorry. I just had a question for the good doctor here. Is there any percentage of a possibility that there's evidence for evolution at all? Like even 1%?
Do I think?
Yeah, is there even 1%?
No, I think it's just impossible based on what I just showed you. Because the requirement for intermolecular fit, the long nucleotide sequences that make up genes to make up these proteins that have to match each other. And that requirement, now remember, a mutation, one, for example, you have two genes that match, that fit each other, like the sperm and egg of this ancestral primate. If the sperm mutates toward the presumptive chimp, any mutation away from the wild type would be extinct because it would have nothing to mate with.
Right.
So that's my big beef with it.
Well, my really simple question was, is there any possibility that evolution does actually happen?
Microevolution only.
Okay.
I think that the restraints of the long nucleotides of the DNA that make up the protein shapes make it so randomly mutating the correct molecular shapes and charges would be just statistically impossible to have them all magically fit in tens of thousands of biochemical processes that make up life.
Yeah, so my second question was, how can you not accept one theory that has some evidence, but totally accept a different theory that you says requires no evidence at all?
Well, I don't think evolution has any evidence, and all of the evidence is universally misinterpreted.
So both theories that we're talking about have zero evidence?
Correct. Intelligent design has no evidence. It's a faith-based theory.
So why do you pick that one instead of the one that science...
It's more intellectually honest.
In what way?
Because evolution is claimed to be a science by those who teach it. Yet clearly, it doesn't meet the criteria of science. So on one hand, it's taught as a science. On the other hand, it doesn't fit the criteria.
Is the Bible science?
No, it's not science. Neither is the history of Rome science.
Okay. It's about evolution.
Yeah, no, I'm just trying to wrap my head around the...
There are faith-based theories and beliefs, and there are scientific.
I want to make just a really quick comment. Side note. Sometimes creationists, and I haven't heard Bart say it, so I don't know if he agrees with this or not, but sometimes they look at symbiotic relationships and say, this has to be designed together. For example, bees and a flower. The flower needs the bee, and the bee gets the honey from the flower. How could these things independently arise? Well, I think an interesting thing to consider, though, too, is that's a beneficial symbiotic relationship. There's also some where one harms the other, such as tapeworms. And there's also, anybody has a tapeworm, they'll know. The other one is somewhere they're benign, where they're just mutually and they don't hurt. So I mean, there's like three possibilities of symbiotic relationships. So
We'll take a question from the guy who's been raising his hand forever.
So I'm a biochemist, and I just really need to address this idea you have between the lock and key bottle of an enzyme. The thing that you need to realize is that 95% of that enzyme can be modified with no change whatsoever in function. So it's really only a small portion that you're talking about that has to, that can't be changed. So really, we can have a series of small gradual changes to an enzyme, and if I make one little change, it's really not going to have any major effect on how it interacts with its gene partner. This can accumulate over a long period of time where small changes eventually add up to where they no longer interact, but it's a false assumption to say if I change, you know, one or two little nucleotides, it's going to cause no function to fall apart, because really we can change almost most of them with plenty of interactions still perfectly viable. So I guess my question is kind of why, what is wrong with the idea that small changes eventually add up to a large change
in that sense? There are two problems with your statement. One is that the theory that there can be large deviations is not based on one enzyme within one species. What it is, it's based on a survey of enzymes among various species that have similar functions. For example, there is the enzyme peptidase, which is a little bit different between man and fish, but they both have similar function, but they have very different structures. Now, the problem is, now that's where this assertion where you come, that you say it comes from, that the two molecules can have the same function, but the problem is that same function is in different species. They're under different regulatory processes. Now, the other thing you mentioned was that there can be a lot of changes within an enzyme. And now I acknowledge that there can be a few changes without messing up a function. Out of a few amino acids in various enzymes that can be changed. But there was actually a study that I'm looking at right now on my computer, how protein stability and new functions trade off. Many enzymes, there's a study done, and I'll show you the reference later, right here if you want, that where they changed a few amino acids within an enzyme, and it still had a little bit of the function at the cost of the stability of the enzyme structure that started to unravel. So your statement about a huge acceptance of enzyme variability is not very accurate, because those are simply different enzymes within different species. They're able to accommodate different structures because they're under different regulatory processes, yes.
But genetic diversity in a single species is, by definition, it results in structural changes like the ones we're talking about. You can change one amino acid and destroy the functionality of a protein, but it has to be a very specific one in the active site of the enzyme. For the overall structure, you can change them all you want. I mean, not all you want, but you can change a huge variability within them, and there's very little change. I mean, that's how we identify active site as a biochemist. You sit there and you say, okay, I'm going to compare across the lineage, and I'm going to find which amino acids are very conserved, and those ones are probably actually crucial to function. But most of them aren't crucial to function. You can change them pretty freely, basically.
Well, there's a difference. There's the active site, and there's regulatory sites. And so there's, I agree with you that there's some leeway. Where we differ is in the degree of leeway and the statistical possibility of generating the nucleotide sequences to generate one enzyme to fit another one. I think our difference is a matter of degree. We'll go on.
We
differ in degree.
My question hasn't been answered. Well, why
can we just see if he has a comment? Because I think it's important that you engage with the audience too.
Okay, go ahead. Mr. Biochemist.
If there's something new to add,
one last comment.
Just the original question. Why a bunch of small changes can't add up to a big change? In terms of enzymes? Yeah.
It depends on, well, because an enzyme has to react with another molecule.
But my original point was that even if there's a small change, the other molecule will be able to interact with it just fine, because it doesn't really change it that much. It takes a long time of a lot of small changes and interplay between the two to actually have a large effect in the end that results in speciation.
Okay, we'll move on to another question. I'd like to point out, though, that is the volume that is required in this room.
Thank you. I have a question for both of you. So I would like to know what, for each of you, what specific scientific evidence would you require to change your position with respect to evolution?
Well, let me just answer real briefly. For me, it would, like I said, my whole point was we have to look at all the hypotheses and see what the best alternative is. And I'd have to see a better hypothesis, you know, a better alternative. So if there's a better alternative, that would sway me. And I don't see a better alternative for now, of course.
The evidence that would sway me is if one could see the progeny of a species give rise to reproductively isolated species. And I mean isolated in every way, even by in vitro, and also have a physiology of different, of an increased complexity. If I saw that, it would change my mind. I haven't seen it.
The gentleman standing to the side.
Okay, Sam, by the way. So just to clarify real fast, you're saying that microevolution can't lead to macroevolution, and you're defining macroevolution as a change in reproductive capability and morphological state. Okay. So my real question is, given the recent kerfuffle that we have with like different microorganisms turning into other microorganisms, do you not consider that a change in species, or is that just not quite big enough, or I'm just confused about that?
My criteria for different species, see species, I acknowledge that species can be taxonomically classified as different, but they might be physiologically the same, such as lions and tigers are taxonomically classified as different, but they can reproduce and have fertile offspring. So even though they are classified as different, I acknowledge that they probably could have had a common ancestor. If they have different numbers of body parts, no one's ever shown that it's possible they could have had a common ancestor. So my criteria for different, now, so you might have bacteria cultured repeatedly, and someone might, in fact, actually, there was a study, E. coli typically does not metabolize citrate. And one microbiologist was gradually able to change it so it did metabolize the compound citrate. And since the microbiology, I have a degree in microbiology, by the way. And so since the microbiology, one of the ways we determine whether or not an organism is E. coli is whether or not it can metabolize citrate. But the problem is, so that might determine its taxonomic classification, but there's no change in the complexity. There's just a change in one enzyme. That's the difference. Yeah, go ahead. Maybe that answer your question.
Yes, I'm confused about what you mean when you say complexity. Because it sounds
complexity
like
is more parts.
Okay, so
a flagellum, I don't think a creature that has 20 flagellum could evolve into a creature with 20, a flagellum with 21 proteins could evolve into a creature with 22 proteins. It's
okay.
Never shown to happen.
So, the, what is it called, the grenade beetle, that beetle that grenade,
bombardier,
thank you. Anyway, so, that insect, there's actually insects there that we know used to be insects that turned into those insects, and they're all kind of coexisting right now. That seems like it would be a pretty significant part to add, and that's been added. Is that not?
I'm not familiar with that, I'm sorry.
The bearded gentleman in the middle.
First of all, I need to mention that I'm not an English native speaker, so I need or I'm impatient maybe to convey my ideas. I need just to point then ask a question. So I need your patience. It will take less than 2 minutes for sure. So I'm a medical doctor myself, and I have researched this notion of evolution for a long time. And I come to the conclusion that, as exactly as Dr. Rask mentioned, and he brought up many evidence, there's tens and tens, maybe hundreds of evidence as exactly what Dr. Rask said. So in my end, I have no doubt that the evolution is false notion, and it does not, it isn't true. Let's say that evolution is okay. Just in the sake of the argument. Does this, prove that, which is really what's important to me and maybe to a lot of people, God exists? Let's say if it is okay, but not, evolution is there. Does it prove that God exists, or does it maybe prove only that maybe the Bible idea of God or how he created human being through 7,000 years ago or something like this is false? Does it prove that science conflicts with the Bible, or does it, or maybe the Holy Book, or does it prove that the science conflicts only one version of the Holy Books? So What if there's a book from God that says that does not contradict anything of the science, and at the same time it has some scientific evidence? If this book speaks good about a lot of things, I mean, that makes sense. He speaks good about Jesus, and in the same time, the book mentioned a lot of scientific evidence that was not discovered until the last two centuries. That I believe God, when He created us, He did not leave us loose without having a really solid evidence. I said 2 minutes. It is just a little bit longer. Without a really solid evidence that guides human beings to Him, He did not leave us loose. So, this evidence might be not popular, but it is a test from God to see whom follows the science and the common sense and whom not. So I just give some examples. So,
what is your question? What is your question?
I'll come to my question. Just I'll continue this. So if there's a question. So if there's a book from God that really have a solid information that was not discovered until one century or two centuries ago, and does not reflect with the idea. This is the question, by the way, to Mr. Truman, I think. Yeah. So that does not contradict. You was looking for a notion, an alternative notion that you can adopt. So if there's, a book from God that says, bring a lot of scientific evidence that wasn't discovered until the last 200 years, and it was revealed 1,400 years ago. And this book does not have any contradiction in the science in the sense of scientific things like the ground is not flat. Actually, it says the ground is.
Okay, are you inferring? Are you talking about the Quran?
Yes, the Quran.
I don't know a whole lot about the Quran and what it has to do with science because I come from a Christian background. Let me just say briefly that. This is a theology question, and theology, there's different theologies about how you deal with science. For example, on one extreme is take a Bible in the most literal way, that's young earth creationism. They deny modern cosmology and modern biology. Some Christians say, we could accept modern cosmology. Those are called older earth creationists. But they reject biology as far as evolution. Then there's also the next step to say, hey, I accept all of science. The Bible has nothing to say about science. These are called evolutionary creationists. This is kind of a new thing. Biologos.com is a major website for this, and Francis Collins is a major Christian coming out with this. And so every one of these positions has different aspects. And I think one thing that's interesting here, Bart is not really telling his alternative, but, I know that he's... What? Okay, there's a whole scientific approach he's coming from. Like one I said on theories, when you look at a hypothesis, you look, how does your theory go against the background science? And, the background science for young earth creationists is that the whole universe is 7,000 years old or so, and there's a worldwide flood. I mean, of course you're going to look at the whole world totally different than if you look at an ancient universe that's 14 billion years old.
Okay. Do we have any more women who have questions?
Okay, so excuse my lack of articulation, I'm a little nervous, but I heard recently that humans actually share more similarities to some non-animal things than they do to chimpanzees. I can't remember exactly what, I was trying so hard to remember what the example was, but I did find that we share 50% similarities to bananas, our DNA, so... I'm just wondering, anything about that?
I've heard that, and I've had to defer to the biologists in the crowd for the answer on that one.
There are similar functions that all life does. There's transport nutrients across cell walls. There's proteins. There's membranes. And so that's why you can account for the similarity of DNA, because there are similar life functions common to all life. Nutrient transport, metabolism, growth.
Well, and I will say too, like I said, genomics is a new field where we're learning so much by looking at animals. And when you look at
look at the animals, you can see how the DNA code kind of tickles through it. There's obviously footprints of descent there. And if you look at something like a banana, you're not going to see that with a human. You know, you're not going to... So I guess I would dispute that we would have more connection with a banana than a chimp or something like that.
No, obviously we don't have more connection with a banana, but I'm saying there are some things that we actually do share more in common with than a chimpanzee.
Yeah. I guess that's something to look into. I'm not sure about the assertion of it.
Okay, the gentleman in the hat, in the back.
I have two short questions, one for each speaker, so cut me off if I'm taking too long. So first for Ardent, I guess you've said a couple of times that you don't think it's fair to criticize a theory without suggesting alternatives. And I wonder why you hold that position. Let me leave with an example. So suppose I've been looking at numbers and I saw that 3 was prime and 5 was prime and 7 was prime. I propose a theory that all odd numbers were prime. Would you need to present an alternative theory of which numbers were prime to criticize that theory?
Well, see, here, no. No, I mean, it's good to say, look, this evidence does not line up, but you don't say, I'm going to throw it out because I think there's a better theory, but I don't really understand that better theory and how it stacks up and things like that. If you're going to... With your prime example, you're going to say, what is a prime number? How do you define a prime number? And you're going to have alternate hypotheses on that.
But do you have to suggest one? Because I would say, no, you should just say, well, 9 is odd and it's not prime, so your theory is bad.
Well, let's look at it this way. Let's say, for example, everybody agrees on the theory of gravity. But let's say, for example, I don't believe in it because I believe in Santa Claus, and Santa Claus violates gravity all the time because of Christmas magic, and that's perfectly fine. And so when you tell me about the theory of gravity, I'll say, no, look at all these problems with the theory of gravity. And you say, well, what's your alternative? It's like, I'm not going to open my mouth and talk about Santa Claus. No, they got problems with gravity, that's it. It's like, why don't you come clean and say, hey, I believe in Santa Claus, and I think it's a better theory, you know?
Second question.
Yes, the second question for Dr. Bart. So you've talked about affirming the consequent many times. You've brought this up, this logical fallacy. So this is a fallacy in deductive logic. When we say, you're saying if A implies B is true, it's not necessarily the case that B implies A. Okay. So do you believe that science is deductive? Because I would argue that science is inductive.
Correct.
And scientific induction rests fundamentally on affirming the consequent. We look at many examples and we say that they give evidence for a theory.
Well, there's a little bit of nomenclature. If inductive reasoning or plausibility reasoning, you can make a conclusion by induction if there's prior observations from analogous situations. If there isn't any, then it's the fallacy of affirming the consequent. So if A, then for example, if it's raining, it must be wet. But if it's wet, you can't with certainty say that it's raining. But it's raining is plausible.
Right. And
now we know it's plausible. We know it's plausible only because of prior observations from analogous situations. That is the key thing. Prior observations from analogous situations, of which in evolution there isn't any, so it commits the fallacy of affirming the consequent. That's my point.
So you were saying maybe that the original claim that A implies B were true, that has not been established.
No, I agree. If evolution were true, you would see transitional fossils, but you can't reverse it.
Okay. How is that different than the rain example, then? Maybe I don't...
Than the what?
Your rain example. I mean,
prior experience from prior experience.
But what has prior experience established, that if it's raining, then it's wet?
Well, we know from prior experience that wetness can be caused by rain. Mm-hmm. We don't know from prior experience that transitional fossils was due to evolution. There's been no prior...
But in this context, it would be that if evolution were true, then we would have transitional fossils.
I agree with that.
Okay. Then isn't it scientific induction to go from if we have transitional fossils, that provides plausibility for evolution?
Only if there's it's plausible only if prior direct observations from other analogous situations.
I don't understand.
Right, we'll take another question.
All right, you ask me after class.
Let me just clarify. I think the problem here is that with evolution, if evolution is true, you can say there's going to be transitional fossils, okay? And I think what Barb is saying is like, well, you know, there may be another alternative where maybe it's not evolution, maybe some other thing where if that's true, you also have transitional fossils. So finding transitional fossils doesn't necessarily mean evolution. The problem is, his alternative is ID, which says there would be no transitional fossils, so it's not making sense there.
Well, here's my challenge. I challenge that evolution is a valid alternative because there's no prior observations or experience to make it a plausible conclusion. That's my key challenge.
I didn't know your question.
All right. The claim is that you think evolution is a better alternative than ID. Mm-hmm. Okay, what makes evolution better? Why is it better?
Because of the evidence, I would say.
Yeah, but all the evidence commits the same fallacy in interpretation.
Well, yeah, so this is where, what's the best interpretation? Let's look at all
what
the different,
makes it, what
the different
makes
interpretations
it,
or different hypotheses.
All right, here's the key thing. Evolution has to meet other criteria. If it's called a science, it has to meet criteria of empiricism, falsifiability. So you may say it's better, but it might not be scientifically. But it is still, you may think it's better based on your opinion and based on faith, but you can't say it's a scientific theory because it doesn't, still doesn't meet the criteria.
Exactly. Okay, well, we can move on to our next question.
Mr. Beener. So, thanks. So, you know, reading the paper that we got, I think the original question here is there any good evidence for evolution? So I'm kind of wondering why we keep going off of that instead of arguing why, Mr. Truman, there's evidence for, is there good enough evidence for evolution? You keep kind of putting it off onto Bart as though he believes in intelligent design, so let's kind of blow holes in that. And in your statements and in your presentation, you said, well, we can't do that. We can't take something and kind of blow holes in it unless we say that there's another alternative that's better. But that doesn't seem like the best evidence for evolution. I mean, if that were the case, then really the stork gives babies. Because when you're four, that was the best
theory. When you're four, right, sure.
But, so you're saying that this is the best evidence is because it's all we have, there's no other alternative, so it must be fact. Must be true.
Well, like I said, we have facts in the world, and the hypothesis is trying to put these facts together in a picture. And so you look at, see, what's the best hypothesis? What's the best explanation? This is called parsimony. What's the most parsimonious with the data? And I don't see any problems with evolution. There's unknowns, but that's the appeal to ignorance to say, you can't prove that, therefore, it doesn't prove anything.
But the fallacy that you're using is, well, it must be true because there's no other better explanation.
Well, plus it makes sense. I mean, like I said, it's like there's footprints. When you look at different genomes, different DNA, you can see the footprints of changes. There's bits changing. Either those really did change or through descent, or else somebody designed it and trying to lead you astray to make it look like there is descent.
I guess the statement is really just using a fallacy really to support that.
Next question we'll go to gentleman in the back,
I have a question for both of you. If certain harmful mutations kill or sterilize organisms, why would their lack of offspring matter when discussing evolution?
Why would a lack of offspring matter in discussing evolution?
Can you just restate the question?
If certain harmful mutations kill or sterilize organisms, why would their lack of offspring matter when discussing evolution?
I don't understand the relationship. Explain yourself.
Because it's...
Are you addressing some assertion I made?
Yeah, because if they're dead or sterile, they can't have kids. But it's still a continuation in that specific species, right?
Well, that's an anomaly. I'm talking about an entire population.
But that's still evolution, right?
I'm sorry, what's evolution?
The mutations.
Mutations are... evolution is a mutation that's carried on through genetic drift and through random mutation and creating a new population with that mutation, not isolated individuals. Evolution is not isolated individuals, it's changes in population.
I think maybe what you're trying to say is you have these different organisms. Some have some really bad mutations and nothing amounts to it, but then some of them have good mutations. So just because there's bad mutations, that doesn't dismiss evolution. It just says that it's not going to continue on or go on while the other stuff does.
I agree.
Let's
Hey, I guess
I appreciate your time, by the way, here, and I think you guys are doing a great job. So I had this question. I don't know your name, but the evolution fellow. So my question is, I'm sorry, Truman. So my question is like let's say intelligent design is plausible, okay? And then I hear you characterize and say, well, let's not entertain like miraculous notions about science. And my question is it seems to me like the notion of design doesn't entail the necessity of a miracle by any notion. It entails like it's almost like you're saying design is miraculous, or is it a notion that would say that complexity of a certain magnitude would just by necessity entail design, and somehow that gets conflated with the miraculous. And I'm not sure if those two things necessarily go together. Could you explain why they do or if they do?
Yeah, I think the ID components, they say we don't identify the ID. So for example, let's say there's an alien who designed everything, and that's perfectly fine. I mean, just like we analyze a watch and say, hey, that thing was designed, maybe humans or animals were designed. So it's just a matter of looking at all the data to see if it makes sense. And one of the hard things what they're trying to do is they're trying to prove scientifically how to identify this design. How do you identify design? It can't be like, oh, well, it can't happen by evolution, because that's just the appeal to ignorance. We don't know. So you can't say that's evidence for ID. So the ID camp is trying to figure out, like SETI, for example, is looking for extraterrestrial signals. They're looking for intelligent signals. So they're trying to, that group is trying to scientifically look for some kind of markers or something, but from what I understand, there's no markers or anything that they can come up with. So.
I'm really bummed that dude left, because I wanted to tell him something, and it's for anybody that kind of was thinking about what he was thinking about evidence for life. I'm a previous student here, and the chemistry textbook for the chemistry class here, just the general textbook, is really, really good at explaining like how life can develop from inanimate things. Right? It explains lipid layers. It explains how RNA can occur based on just in their studies that talk about it. So if that's interesting to anybody, I would highly suggest the chemistry textbook. Okay, so my question is, so you do believe in microevolution. Do you think, though, that the only ingredient missing to make your jump from micro to macro was just time? Because essentially it would be time that could make the difference between a species diversifying.
That's what an evolution is. I don't think time can make up for
the probability
of having multiple DNA nucleotide sequences in the right permutations to have thousands of interacting molecules.
But you do believe in mutation, right, because of microevolution?
I believe in mutation.
Okay. So do you think, though, that it's possible that, I mean, because doesn't that assume that the nucleotides are essentially moving at a fixed rate with essentially species moving along?
It doesn't matter what rate they move at.
But if a mutation can make a jump, I guess is what I'm saying. So assuming instead of taking 19 or to the negative 23 zeros of whatever your probability was there, do you think that mutation can account for that? So there might be these jumps that can overcome some maybe some statistical improbability.
Well, that's what I'm saying. It's statistically impossible to have that.
Even with mutation?
Yes, mutations don't. Here's the thing. If you have rapid mutations, you'll just have a hodgepodge of nucleotides with no purpose, with no fitting. The molecules need to fit and interact with each other. For example, there's a blood clotting. I don't know if the doctor knows here. A blood clotting mechanism, there's what's called the coagulation cascade. It's a series of 12 proteins that all come together in perfect harmony after you cut yourself. They all fit each other in a specific order. And each of them is generated by nucleotides, which are probably dozens, if not hundreds, of nucleotides long. Yet they all fit. And because of the permutations are so massive, as I showed with my example of just six, I think it's statistically impossible to think that you can arrange those nucleotides such that they generate molecules, all of which fit together in perfect harmony, times a million. Mm-hmm.
But then hemophilia comes about because of genetic mutation, so doesn't that kind of just, that basically is cutting your cascade at some level too?
Right, well, that proves my point. It shows that there's not much room for error. Now, I agree with the biochemist that there
is some... But you can still procreate.
Yes, of course.
But
we're talking about how it's generated to begin with. Mm-hmm. We're not talking about minor mutations after everything's all together. Mm-hmm. We're talking about how you can get from a coagulation cascade of 6, which is in sea squirts, for example, to a coagulation cascade of 12. I don't think it's possible, and no one's ever shown that it could happen.
Thank you.
Yeah.
But just one quick comment too. Sometimes, I mean, we're overwhelmed. Like I said, we evolved this middle world idea, and we're just overwhelmed with these amazing biochemical processes in the body. It's kind of like, you know, earlier humans, or even a lot of people now, they can't imagine that the Earth is spinning at 1,000 miles per hour. That's crazy. I don't feel it. 1,000 miles per hour around the equator? We can't be spinning that fast. And we're going through space at 68,000 miles per hour. Are you kidding me? I don't feel that kind of wind on me. But this is the kind of thing that is just so much bigger than our world that we're used to.
The lady in the back.
I have a question for Dr. Rask. You make a point to emphasize that knowledge has to come from prior experience. But many progresses that we have made doesn't come from prior knowledge. When Thomas Edison, he invented the light bulb, we didn't know. I saw this one time that illumination can be fueled by electric energy. He just tried it until it became possible. So not all knowledge have to come from prior experience. How do you respond to that?
Right. Well, you misinterpreted me. I didn't say all knowledge.
You tried it.
I say in order to do induction, which is making conclusions from things you didn't see, there has to be prior experience. Now, your analogy about Edison is from direct empirical evidence. That doesn't apply. What I'm talking about is when there's not empirical evidence and you make jump to some conclusions of how something could have occurred when no one saw it. Edison actually did empirical direct observation. So the prior experience situation doesn't apply. The prior experience in your case is at the time.
I don't want to say what at the time means, because before the electric light bulb, what are the sources of illumination?
Well, I don't know. I don't understand. My point is that you can make scientific conclusions from direct observation. You can make conclusions, but if there is no direct observation, you can make inferences based on prior experience only.
So that Edison observed somewhere that there are light bulbs?
I
feel. Well, thank you. Gentleman with glasses in the middle there?
Me?
Yes.
I have a question for Truman. So I'll use an example before I ask my question. So we happened for a while to work for the same company that makes complicated computer chips. And we both know how computer chips are designed. There are decades of experience. Every new design reuses probably 80 or 90% of the older designs. And one analog to the, another biologist, so I'm going to need some help with terminology, but the example where different sequences of nucleotides encode the same enzyme for the same, I need help there, but you know, the different encodings that result in the same function. You draw a conclusion from the presence of the exact same sequence, whereas different sequences could be present to realize the same function. You draw a conclusion that there's not only common ancestry, but also random mutation and natural selection are certainly behind the picture that you see. Now, looking at, if you didn't know anything about computer chip design, which of course you do, you looked at a modern generation chip and you see out of, let's take a simple function such as adding two numbers. There are 20, maybe 50, maybe 100 different architectures for making a simple circuit, like an adder. And you see an adder in a modern chip, and you see an adder of the same architecture where one of the 99 adder architectures would do, and you see the same design over and over again. You see some wires that are routed from one end of the chip that had a function going to a different part of the chip that was justified later, converted into something that doesn't make any sense. Would you, from that evidence alone, not knowing what is exactly behind the process of designing those chips, would you conclude that they arose as a result of random mutations of natural selection?
No.
And if not, tell me why.
Well, see, this is what I mentioned in my talk about mimetic evolution. That's the evolution of ideas and technology. That's totally different than biology. Just like biology, biological evolution is totally different than cosmological evolution.
But information that is encoded in DNA is very analogous to the information that's encoded in a computer program or in a chip design.
Oh, I don't think so at all. No, two totally different things. No, there's no analogy there.
Why not?
We're going to have to go on to the next question.
Well, the computer program, for instance, it's a sequence of symbols, 26 English letters arranged in keywords and names.
Yeah, it is. I mean, I could.
And so
it's
a microprocessor. Described in a hardware description language.
It sounds like we don't have enough time to answer that question properly. So we're just going to move on to the other gentleman.
To the doctor, the evolutionary science, or at least the scientists who study evolution, call it science. You don't accept that as real science. How about other sciences? Have you found other fields of sciences which are quite skeptical about, as you are, evolution?
Climate change. I don't. And I won't elaborate. Because here's the thing, I'm very skeptical of theories which involve these large extrapolations over several hundreds of years. I'm very skeptical about anything that involves these long time-based extrapolations.
Yeah, because
just in general, I'm very skeptical of those.
You can't replicate climate change in a lab for over a day or a week or much better for you can't trust it.
My point is that you asked me what else I don't believe in. I don't believe anything can be called a science if it involves extrapolations over tens of thousands or millions of years.
So you're a doctor. You are obviously studying
orthopedic
biology
surgeon.
And so forth. So
I
gather that you would, in general, have a pretty positive attitude about science, which is the basis of our modern life, of our
real science,
technology, and so forth.
I have a positive attitude about real science that results in something productive.
Well, I just want to suggest that you yourself describe your approach as faith-based, which means it's not science-based. How can you do a rational criticism of a science if you counter it with something that's, quote, faith-based, based on some book that was written by some guys several thousand years ago who had no concept of science at all?
The same way I believe in the history of Rome. It was written thousands of years ago, I believe that. Same way I believe the history of the United States, written hundreds of years ago by people who are long since dead. We all believe in things that are written down by people long since died. We either choose to believe it or we don't. You can't do a test to see whether or not Julius Caesar was emperor at the turn of the millennium.
It is 9 o'clock, so we are at our time limit. Thanks for all the wonderful questions.